come on a little early if you can let someone know about the broadcast. We're going to finish up the message we started this morning on the mystery of the rapture and the four emphases and the four places in the New Testament that God points out about the rapture of the church. And let someone know. And we'll take a few minutes. And if you would, thank you. I appreciate so many that watched this morning. And then also, if you could, share this with someone. Let them know. Maybe a person who doesn't know the Lord, you could share this with. And it would be a great encouragement for them to think about this time. The Lord's coming, I believe, is near. And may God just speak to our hearts. You listen now. And just in a few minutes, we'll be coming on with the message, the mystery of the rapture of the church. Thankful for the wonderful singing and music, and we're so thankful for this opportunity that we can share. I sure enjoyed sharing this morning there on the steps of the church, and could I say that it was cold on that porch, and I had to keep moving to stay warm, and I am so thankful for the ability for that we have to get the message out. I want to thank our church family. You have been absolutely wonderful. The prayers, we've been on a diet, but you've sent food, and we appreciate it. But I tell you, and cards and calls, and then what touches my heart, that many of you have been in contact with some of our elderly, some of our shut-ins, some of those who may not be able to get out, and even some of them who don't have the means of watching this on Facebook. And so let's stay in touch, and let's grow closer together while we're apart. And for that day, we're going to get to come back together. And I believe God's using this. I believe God really is going to do greater things. I believe we're going to have greater services. I believe we're going to have greater, our hearts are going to be, I believe, challenged to do more for the Lord than we've ever done before. And I'm just praying that this will be something that will touch, it's touched my heart. I sure miss being, I never thought I'd miss fellowship like this. I've never saw fellowship. Well, I've always loved a fellowship, be with God's people. And, you know, I think about how now it makes us so hungry for that fellowship, for that, what it means to shake a person's hand, what it means for somebody to say, I love you. God bless you, brother. Sister, you've been a blessing. And to just encourage one another. I tell you, there's been nothing like it in all the world, but we miss it now because we cannot have that. But soon we will have. We're going to have drive-in church next Sunday. We're praying about maybe having a service inside on Mother's Day. Now, we may not be able to do that, but But I wish you'd pray with me about that. It's been a lot. It's been heavy on my heart as a pastor to know what to do. And I know some of our people are so, well, they're just wanting to be together. There's something about that remnant, something about that body. And when you're in that body and you're a believer, I'll tell you, you want to be there. And this morning we had a great crowd of people that came and drive in church. And we're so thankful. May the Lord bless you. If you have a prayer request, you can put it on there and we'll be sure to look at it and pray. And then if you put your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, please let us know that you trust it, or you have a question about that. What about this rapture thing? What about this coming of the Lord? Where's that in the Bible? I don't understand that. Where would I find in the Bible? Well, that's what the message is about. And I pray today God will speak to your heart and help you through this message. I want you to take your Bible, look in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Chapter 15, the book of 1 Corinthians. And we're going to be looking at verse number 51. And we're going to be talking about the mystery of the rapture. Now, I said this morning, looking, and I dealt with the first two of these. And by the way, the word mystery there that Paul, now he was the one that God gave the mystery. There are 27 times in the New Testament the word mystery is mentioned. 14 of those times, there are 14 mysteries, 14 different mysteries, 27 times he mentioned them. Now, mystery is not mentioned in the Old Testament, but it's hard saying. So you come into the New Testament, and it's not something that is mysterious. It's something, it is what's not been revealed yet. Now, God has chose to reveal it. God has chose to show us these wonderful truths. And that's what we're talking about. The rapture is a mystery. Now, the second coming of Christ is not a mystery. There are many promises of that, but there are only four places out of 318 times it mentions the second coming. Now, remember, the coming of the Lord is in two parts, his first coming for his church, and then his coming back with his church, his secret coming, his second coming. Out of those 314 times, there are 318 times, I'm sorry, there are four times he mentions these four things about the rapture, four times. And we looked at the first one. First of all, he's going to emphasize a place, John 14. I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place, I will come again. And we dealt with that, about the place that he's gone to prepare. And then the second one was, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 through 18, he talks about a person, the Lord himself, a place, John 14, a person in 1 Thessalonians 4 and verse 16 through 18. I'm going to prepare a place, and then in 1 Thessalonians 4, a person that he's coming back, this person's coming. And then we're looking now at the third one, and that is, we're going to talk about the purpose, and that's found in Philippians chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. He talks about our citizenship. He talks about our vile body. And so he's talking about the purpose, the person, the place in John 14, the person in 1 Thessalonians 4, and then the purpose in Philippians chapter 3. And then in 1 Corinthians 15 that we'll be looking at and finish up today, he's talking about the pattern. The pattern. How can this old corruptible body, something's going to happen for this corruption, this body that's dying, this body that's going back, as we see every day, to the dust from which it came. Well, he answers that question, and only Paul gives us the answer, and we find that there in 1 Corinthians chapter number 15. So I want to deal with those last two things. We talked about several things this morning, and that dealt with those first two. But today, this evening, I want to talk about in verse number 58, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 51. Look at it, if you will, please. 1 Corinthians 15, 51. Behold, I show you a mystery. Now, here's the sacred secret. Here's something that's not been revealed before. It's now being revealed. We shall not all sleep, but we all shall be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trump shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and this, he said, and it shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So then, when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall then shall we be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of sin sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, we're going to talk about that mystery. And of course, this all four of these that we've looked at gives us some detail on that. But look in Philippians chapter 3, if you would, for the third one. And here we're looking at Philippians chapter 3 and verse number 19 and 20. And this talks about the emphasis of the purpose. He's going to tell you about our citizenship that's in heaven. And he tells us about what's going to happen to this body. And he gives us here the purpose of that. Chapter 3, verse number 19. Verse number 20. He says, for our conversation is in heaven, from which also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like his glorious body, according to the working whereby he's able to subdue all things unto himself. Now here we find the emphasis is on the purpose, the transformation of the body. Now, Paul remembers his days without Christ. That's what Philippians 3. And he remembers his days when he was a Pharisee, when he was Christless. And he tells a little bit about that. And he said, I want to tell you all those things I count but dung, worthless, refuge, nothing. And so Paul talks about his life without Christ. And then we find Paul remembers when he became a Christian, his conversion. And here, when he was wonderfully and gloriously saved on the road to Damascus, you'll remember the wonderful testimony that he gave there. And then we find Paul relates us to our citizenship. And he tells us about this. The word conversation there is citizenship. In other words, you are a citizen of another country. We are citizens of heaven. If you've been born again, if you got the second birth, your first birth identifies you with a family here and with the nation you're born in. But that second birth reminds you of a place that you got. You are a citizen of heaven. And now we have a citizenship there. A building, he said, not made with hands of God. A house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. And you know what? I thought about this. We've come from sin to salvation. We've come from death to life. We've come to darkness to light. We've come from being afar off to becoming near. We've come from hopelessness to hope, but we still have a vile body. We still have a body that's vile, that needs redemption. As you remember, Paul said in Romans chapter 8 and verse 23, we groan, waiting for the adoption and the redemption of the body. You see, your body is not redeemed. Your body is, that's God redeemed and save your soul, but your body is not redeemed. Oh, that's what he's talking about here. And we find this wonderful truth. And he says, Paul reminds them that they must have a change. You see that word change, if you have your Bible there. In verse 21, the word change is, we get the word metamorphosis. And here you'll find that, in other words, when the best way I can describe it is when you take a caterpillar and the caterpillar becomes a butterfly. That's what the Lord is saying. You've had such a radical change. You've become a new person. That's what Paul said there in 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things, aren't you glad that passed away? All things, all things are continuing to become new in our life as a believer. Now, he talks about the vile body to a glorious body, fashioned just like his glorious body. In other words, when you think about that, that my body is going to be like this. Now, how can that be? How is that possible? That a dead, decaying, dying person, and you look at a body that's died, you look at that corpse, and many times sin and suffering and sickness is so almost disposed of that body You look at it and you say, can there ever be any hope for that body? Well, there is, my friend. That's what he's saying right here. How is that possible? How can that be? The Lord Jesus is going to fashion. You see the word fashion? It's like, could I say this? The Lord Jesus is a fashion designer. He's the one who created Adam. He's the one who made this world. He has the power. If you look at our little world, the earth, it's a little speck out there. And all those millions of galaxies and billions of stars and other galaxies and everything. Oh, I'm telling you right now, but our Lord who designed all of that, he's going to refashion. He's going to fashion. He's a fashion designer. He made Adam, and you know what? He made Adam perfect. But he made Adam with the ability to choose. And Adam chose to sin and rebelled. Now he's going to make me like himself. You are going to be like the Lord. Isn't that going to be wonderful? And I'm going to be like him, perfect and without the ability to sin. Wow. I'll tell you what, I'm so ashamed of many things I've said and done. And I've had to come to the Lord and say, Lord, it's me again. And Lord, I said something I shouldn't have said. I thought something I shouldn't have thought. And I've had to confess, Lord, I've sinned. I've come short. And you know what? That's what 1 John 1 and verse 7 says. If we confess our sins, God is faithful, verse 9, and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Aren't you glad as a believer you can come and say, dear Lord, I'm sorry I've sinned. It's not a rabbit foot, but it is where you as a believer. In fact, he comes right on down in 1 John chapter 2 and says, my little children, oh, little children, these things write unto you that you sin not. But if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. Aren't you glad he doesn't want us to sin? But if we do, and we will, and we do, I'm glad. But oh, one day I won't be able to sin. Now, you say, preacher, how is it there are three things that are sure that you can count on? If you're thinking about this, how can it ever be that I won't ever sin again? Well, look at 1 John 3:2. You got your Bible? If you don't, just somehow put that in your mind or write that down if you can. And I want you to see these three things. Absolute, sure. There's some things you can't be dogmatic about. But I tell you, I can be double dogmatic about this because listen what it says. In 1 John chapter 3 and verse 2, he said there in verse 1, beloved, now we're the sons of God. And then it says, it doth not yet appear. Beloved, right now, verse 2, are we the sons of God? Doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know, listen now, we know that when he shall appear, we shall see him, we shall be like him. And here's the three things you find there in 1 John. If you're looking at it there, you'll find, first of all, he shall appear. Now that's one of the promises. Somebody asked me one time, will I be bald-headed in heaven? Will I be fat? Will I be ugly? Well, I can't answer all those questions, but I tell you one thing, I do know. We're going to see him. That's what he said here in 1 John chapter 3 and verse number 2. He says here, and he shall appear, and then secondly, we shall be like him, and then thirdly, we shall see him. Those three things. Oh, mark it down. You can put, I don't know what, you know, he said right here, we know we're saved, but we don't know what's going to happen in between. We don't know what's going to appear, but we know when he appears. When we're going to be like him. We're going to see him as he is. And what a promise. He shall appear, we shall be like him, and for we shall see him as he is. What a promise God gives us. And what you see is what you get. What you see, you're going to see him, that's what you get. And you're going to be like him. I'm going to be, and I know, you know, those children sing that song, he's still working on me to make me what I ought to be. Well, I'm going to tell you, friend, I'm going to be a finished product. He's going to fashion me so on that day. Oh, I'm going to be like him. I'm going to be with him. I'm going to see him just like he is. So, you know what? When I think about that, like him, we'll think like him. We'll love like him. We'll act like him. We will, I believe, live like him. And you know, Romans 8, 28 through I guess verse 30, it talks about when you get down to verse 28, he says, now we know all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his What's that word? Purpose. Purpose. And then he begins to lay down and he says, here's the purpose. You're going to be conformed to be like him. The confirmation, it'll be complete. Right now, he's still working on me. He's still knocking off a lot of rough play. But the completion's going to be in 1 John 3:2. When you see him, when he appears, and you're like him. God says when you, because you've got a citizenship over there, because you're a child of God. That's why in John 14, the emphasis here is on a place. In 1 Thessalonians 4, the emphasis is on a person. The Lord's coming, the place he's prepared. But here, that you find that it's the pattern that God gives us here and what a pattern he has for us. And so we see that wonderful truth. He's able, Philippians 3:20, he's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask according to the power that works in us. And so what a wonderful truth we have there. So we thank God for this ability. So he gives us here his pattern. I think I said purpose, but here in Philippians 3, 20 and 21, here's God's purpose. What's God's purpose? To make us like him, to change our vile body, to a metamorphosis that will take place. And that's the reason why your body can't go to heaven. Your body is corrupt. My body's corrupt. And that's why Paul said, hey, I'm going to tell you, I've got a mystery. You want your mystery solved? You want the answer to these questions? Paul said, I can give them to you. Now, I want you to look in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And look at verse 51. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And here we find that the problem at the church of Corinth, that some doubted the resurrection. And some even denied the bodily resurrection. And the reason why, if you'll notice in verse 34 of 1 Corinthians 15, he says some. He said, again, in verse 35, listen, verse 35, 1 Corinthians 15, 35, but some man will say, how are the dead raised up? And with what body do they come? Look at verse 50. He said, now flesh and blood's not going to inherit the kingdom of God. And he said, are you telling me that once this body, once that you die and go to the grave, that your spirit one day would be connected back to the body? Well, you see, the Sadducees denied that, and they influenced the Jews. The Epicureans, that was a group that influenced the Gentiles. And neither one of them believed in the resurrection. So they denied that. And so they had influenced these believers here. And what they had taught is that once your spirit leaves your body, that's a great thing. The body is done. The body is, it's nothing. It's been a prison. It's had your spirit inside. Now you're free to go and intermingle with the spirits. Well, Paul denies that. Paul corrects that. And Paul deals with that. And right here in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, we see this wonderful promise. Now, look if you will, and I want to talk to you about the importance of the message of the resurrection. Now, go back, and because it starts with the resurrection of Christ, and it ends with the resurrection of the saints. In verse 1 and 2, we find the importance of the message of the resurrection. Now, we don't have a gospel to preach if there's no bodily resurrection. If Christ did not rise bodily, and if he didn't get out of the grave, and his spirit come back in that body, that same body he was crucified in, then we have no hope. But so here in verse 1 and 2, the importance of the message of the resurrection. Paul says three times, you'll notice vain. Look at verse 2. He said, now, unless you have believed in vain. In other words, he said, you're saved because you received this message of the gospel. And he says in verse number 14, he tells us there again, you'll find the word vain. And he tells us there, if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is vain. Why am I am an absolute fool if Christ, I'm a liar. I'm a deceiver, and it's vain if Christ did not rise. Again, he uses the word vain. Look at verse 17. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. Ye are yet in your sin. You're still a sinner. Your loved ones has perished. He tells it later, and there's no hope for them. Oh, my friend, I'm going to tell you, listen what Paul said here. Here is the importance. Look back at verse 1, 1 Corinthians 15. I preached, and boy, did Paul ever preach, and he preached the gospel. He said, not only did I preach, but look at verse 1, you received. I preached the gospel. You received. You received that message. And then he said, you were saved. Look at verse 2. You were saved. Now, look also, he said, wherein you stand. There in verse number 1, he said, unless here, he tells us there, that you believed in vain. Oh, my friend, the gospel is so important. He gives you the importance of it. He gives you the ingredients of the gospel. And you know what they are, the death, the burial, and the resurrection. Death, Christ died for our sins. And that's the payment. Burial, that's the putting away. Death, he died, he paid for sin, he's put them away. And then resurrection, he got up, thank God. And that's the proof they're paid for. That's the reason why in John 11, he said there to Martha, he said, I am the resurrection, the life. He that believeth in me, though he was dead, yet shall he live. Yet shall he live. Here's the promise we have. And of course, Lazarus was raised again and even died again. But thank God, there is a resurrection. So we find the ingredients there that's mentioned in the death, burial, and resurrection. Now, it's not trusting. I've heard this said, and I've probably said this myself, I'm sure I have. Trusting in the finished work of Calvary or the cross. Friend, I'm going to tell you, Calvary is not the finished work. The cross, it's believing in the living, resurrected Savior. It's not just believing he died on the cross. It's believing he died on the cross, and he was buried, and he rose again. That's the gospel, and it's going beyond the cross. It's seeing the cross and believing the living, resurrected Christ. And when you think about that, we must get sinners to Calvary, but we must get them beyond to trusting in a living Lord. What did Paul say in Romans 10:9? That if thou, you put your name in there, shall trust, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in thine heart that God had raised him from the dead, I love this, thou shalt be saved. Oh, thank God for that wonderful truth. So there's the ingredients, death, burial, resurrection. The importance, he said it's vain now if you don't believe. But then he comes down and he gives us an illustration. And this is what I love. And this answers the question. And by the way, where we got the word mystery was in verse 51. But I want to point out a few things here. The illustration of a bodily resurrection. Some, as we see in verse 35, and they're saying now, how are the dead raised up? And with what body they come? Do they come? Paul uses three illustrations. And first of all, he's going to prove the resurrection of the body of the believer. He's going to use, first of all, botany. And he's going to take you there. If you look, and he said it's like a seed that goes into in the ground. And when you see that truth there, and he tells us this in verse number 37, and when you sow, thou sowest not that body that will be put, but bare grain, and it may chance wheat or some other grain. And he goes on and talks about how that grain comes up, how you've sown that seed. So he uses here, first of all, the illustration of botany. And then secondly, he uses the illustration of biology. Now he goes on, I won't go through all this, but he says in verse 39, he said, now you've got all kinds of flesh. You've got that of birds, and you've got that of beasts, and you've got that. And he talks about the fish and then of men and of different animals and so forth. So he said, just like that. And he's talking about this biology. And then he gives us one. The third is taken from astronomy. And he uses the sun, the moon, and stars. First of all, botany. Secondly, biology. And thirdly, astronomy. And so he illustrates that. And then he gets down to the nitty-gritty. And in verse 51, down to verse 58, the answer to the question of verse 35. And that is, again, he says, but some man will say, how? How? You can almost say, how are the dead raised up, and with what body do they come? You mean they're going to have a real body like we had here? And so the question, so Paul answers that, and I think, You know what? 1 Corinthians 15 is Mount Everest. It's probably one of the greatest passages, chapter in all the Bible. It's the Mount Everest. I'm telling you, it answers things that honestly our hearts are just longing for. And it unveils a mystery. By the way, here God's mystery, the sacred secret, that's what the word mystery means. And it's something that wasn't known hitherto before, but now is made known. And this is the first time, and look what Paul says there in verse 51. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we all shall be changed. And he talks about this, he tells us about this change, this mystery. He said, in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. Now, I want to give you just a few things, and we'll go down through there and take these scriptures. First of all, here's the mystery solved. You know, I don't know about you, but I like a mystery. Some of you love reading books on mystery. Some of you like watching mystery, and you wonder who did it, and you're in your mind thinking, well, here's the mystery solved. Paul said, let me just solve this mystery for you right here. God has given it to me. I'm going to give it to you. And here he talks about the sleeping ones. That's what death is. To a child of God, it's like sleep. Paul mentioned that to the church. We shall not all sleep, but we all shall be changed. And he says here, and over in 1 Thessalonians, he talks about that, about those sleeping ones, those who sleep in Jesus, will God bring with him. So here we see the sleeping ones are changed. And what a change that, that's the metamorphosis. That is the change that takes place. And he says here, and you'll find not only the sleeping ones are changed, but then he talks about the suddenness of this change. He said it's going to be in a moment. It's going to be in a twinkling of an eye. And that's one of the fastest things known to man is the blinking of the eye. But he said not a blink or not a, you know, it's going to be in the twinkling of an eye. And that the Lord comes again. And we find this take place. So the suddenness of it, it's going to be so quick, so sudden. It could be today. Oh, my friend, what would happen if the Lord were to come before? I wonder what tomorrow's news would be. COVID-19 might be, there are a lot of people have died, but we can't find them. There's no trace. There are neighbors who are looking, and they say our neighbors haven't come out. There are children looking for parents, parents looking for children. There are people, there are plane crashes, car wrecks. There's a doctor who has a patient and he's just about to do open heart surgery and they're gone. I mean, they're gone. I'm telling you the suddenness of it. And my friend, that's why you need to prepare to meet God. That's really why you need to realize one day our dear Lord's coming. And oh, my friend, he says the sleeping ones are going to be changed. The suddenness of this happening, it's going to be in a moment, the twinkling of an eye. And he said, now, what's going to trigger this is a sound. And he tells us there in 1 Corinthians chapter number 15, he said, here, there's going to come in a moment, twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. By the way, there are four last things. There are four last things in chapter 15. Could I just point them out briefly? And you'll see this. In fact, Paul said that he was the last one in verse 8. Here you'll find he was the last he was seen of me, Paul says. And then there is also, the last enemy in verse number 26. And then in verse 45, there's the last Adam. But here, he's going to talk about the last trump. By the way, there are four first things. And there's a great message in the four first things and the four last thing. But here's the four last thing. The last trump. Now this is, please, don't believe this is the trumpet, the last trump over there of the trumpet judgment in the book of Revelation. If you do, you're going to go halfway through the tribulation. That would be a split rapture.